So what do we trust God with? Well, one thing we trust God with is that He will be with us, that we're not in this alone. It doesn't matter if you feel like it's alone. I've told people, I know you don't think God is with you. I know you don't feel that at all, but that doesn't change it. He is with you. I know He's there. Whether you feel it, I hope you come to feel it, because that would be an encouragement. But whether you feel God's presence or not, it doesn't change that the Lord is with you. He said, I will never leave you or forsake you. What did He say? I will never leave you or forsake you, whether you feel it or not. I think another thing is that it is not wasted. This goes back to the section we talked about, suffering. God can reclaim even depression. He can use it for His purposes. He can use it to show your faithfulness to Him, your trust in Him, even when you feel nothing. Part of depression is you lose a sense of God's presence quite often. There's just nothing there. C.S. Lewis talked about when his wife died, he said, I heard the sound of a door slamming, bolting, double bolting, and then the silence. That's what it feels like. Was God far away? No, but it felt like it. And there's nothing you can do sometimes to make God feel near. You have to just bear this, knowing that He's there. This really is faith, by the way. It's an easy faith when you sense God's presence, isn't it? That's kind of an easy faith. When you don't sense His presence, that's hard faith. But He is there. And we want to help people just say that over and over, because it's so difficult to believe when you can't feel it. You need to teach people about depression. Help them understand, whether you're counseling or in other places. We probably should all expect to be depressed sometimes. Things happen that have that effect. There are depression-prone situations, like we've just described. Remember the word normalize? Well, that's one thing we do here. My friend, anyone going through this would feel depressed. I know someone over here who went through what you've gone through, and they felt depressed. This is a normal thing. It feels bad, but it's not abnormal. What you're going through is what all people face. You want to teach them some coping skills. How do you handle your anger when you're depressed? Because it's more on the surface. You might say, I've never been this way before, and now I just lash out. Okay, how can we help so that you behave properly, that you don't sin in the midst of your depression? Can we help them manage stress somehow? Can we help find ways to lower the stress during this depression, if possible, and how to think differently? We want to encourage them to have support from other people. When you're depressed, you want to withdraw. You want to be left alone. You don't think you're a very nice person to be around, and you probably aren't, but that isn't healthy. You need to be around people. When I was depressed as a pastor, there were times when I had to get up and go to meetings. I had to go to meetings. And I didn't want to go. I did not want to go. But I found that when I went into that meeting, I had to act more normally. I had to do business. I had to think. And it was good therapy for me, even though I didn't want to be there. You've got to get people, if they'll go, into social settings, especially at church. You need to urge them to reach out or ask, give you permission to invite other people to reach in, but have some relationships. And one more thing, physical activity is healthy. Physical activity helps. I have a good friend in our church who deals with depression often. And one of his life practices, he goes to a gym every morning. He swims, he works out, because he can tell the difference physically and emotionally if he doesn't. Physical activity, going for a walk, about 20 minutes of a walk starts to change the chemistry in your brain. So, Pastor, after a terribly hard Sunday morning, when you're depressed and you just want to go take a nap, I've heard the counsel, it's better go for a walk. Just go for a walk, and after about 20 minutes of walking, you're going to start to feel differently. It's chemical. It's not spiritual, it's just chemical. And you start to shift. I'm going to tell you a story. This is from a blog by a young woman named Addie Zierman in the United States. She writes how she struggled with depression, and it was so severe she decided to go to a counselor, a Christian counselor. She said it had been a year of depression and anger, a year of drinking too much, too fast. In a thousand small ways and a few really big ways, I'd been hurt by the churches where I sought refuge. And so in many ways, it was the loneliest year. She says the first therapist, Christian counselor she went to, she chose on purpose. She said, I knew I needed somebody who could help me think through my all tangled up evangelical roots. She'd grown up in church and things were confusing to her. I needed somebody who'd understand, so she went to a Christian counselor. She said, I was this close to giving up on faith altogether, and I was looking for someone to help me keep holding on. She says, I remember that it was fall and it was sunny. I don't remember the therapist's name, only that she was small and severe. And she had that tired middle of the afternoon look about her. I sat down on the couch and she sat at her desk. What did we learn about that? Don't sit across the desk. Her body turned toward the window. Wait a minute, your counselee is over here. What is that? When I launched headlong into my story, she stayed bent over her legal pad, scribbling. I sobbed and she gestured toward the Kleenex box without looking up. What is this? What's wrong with that picture? Isn't that awful? She said, I told her the whole thing from the very beginning. I told about the old on fire for Jesus days and the slow burning out. I gave the details, the pain. I told about those mornings I spent with my Bible, needing God so much I could barely breathe and feeling only silence. I told her about the tequila and the churches and the boy I should never have started talking to at the coffee shop that day. I told her how close things had come to falling apart. When I got done, she tapped her pencil, got up, walked to the whiteboard, and silently she drew the drawing of the two cliffs. If you use this to share the gospel with somebody, God is over here, you're on this side, you have this chasm in the middle. And Addie was furious. She says, I know that. That's not where I am. This therapist assumed that she had to start from the beginning and come to Jesus. Well, it was a horrible experience, and she left. She said, didn't you hear a thing I said? When I left the office that day, I barely could muster up goodbye, and I knew I'd never go back. She was a bad therapist. Then she said, I went to another one. To her strength. Let me read what she said. She sat across from me in her swivel chair and she said gently, let's check in. And the way she said it and the way she listened was gospel. Isn't that wonderful? The way she said it and the way she listened was gospel. It was like she was saying, look, this is hard. You're all tangled up in the darkness, but you're not failing. It was like she was saying, you are still held. You are still loved. You're suspended over the void. You are holding on to that cross with one baby finger, feeling like you're going to lose it if God doesn't grab hold of you. You are in the hard, beautiful middle of faith. You're exactly where you're supposed to be.
We invite you to participate in the International Bible Teaching and Gospel Sharing Project. Whether these Christian expanded educational opportunities will become available to people around the world depends on all of us. We very much need and appreciate your prayer and financial support. For more information, please visit tvsseminary.com.